Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Zatarain's, a New Orleans tradition since 1889. From our studios in the Southern Food and Beverage Museum in New Orleans, this is Louisiana Eats. I'm Poppy Tooker. In case you haven't heard, New Orleans is celebrating a big birthday this year. It's been 300 years since the city's founding, and we're joining in the party on this week's Louisiana Eats. Of course, there's bubbly involved. The Abita Brewing Company has issued a special limited edition ale just for the occasion, Maison Blanc, crafted with Sauvignon Blanc grapes. Abita's president, David Blossman's here to pop the top on that brew. Then we'll go back in time when the French Quarter was a Native American settlement and learn all about the historic New Orleans collection's Tricentennial exhibit from the archeologists who literally dug up many of the amazing items currently on display in their Royal Street galleries. Happy birthday, New Orleans. Let's get your party started on this week's Louisiana Eats.
My name is David Blossman. I am the president of the Abita Brewing Company.
David Blossman is a man ahead of his time. Long before it was legal for him to drink, David was experimenting with home brewing, making small batches of beer as a hobby. At 17 years old, he invested his teenage savings into what would become the Abita Brewing Company. Over 30 years later, he's now the president. David joined us to talk about Abita's pioneering role in the craft beer movement, beginning with its founding in 1986.
Well, Abita started with two home brewers, Russ Cummings and Jim Patton, that had a passion for their hobby, which was brewing beer. I also had a passion for that at a younger age. And when I heard that a brewery was opening up in my backyard, I was like, wow, you know, I got to be a part of this.
What were you doing at the time?
I was in high school.
How do you go from there to becoming president of Abita Beer?
Well, I went on and graduated high school. And went
that's
to,
always good.
Yeah, that's good. Louisiana State University. And I was going to major in some sciences. But I sat in my first chemistry class, and there was about 300 or 400 people there. And I'm like, you know, I dropped that class as fast as a bad check, man. So I went to my aptitude, which was math, and I just figured, let me stick with what my family does. And, you know, I'm going to go in accounting, and I'm a major in accounting. And that's what I did. And so I did that, and I worked. My first job was in New Orleans at Ernst & Young, One Shell Square, and I worked at public accounting a couple of years, and then I worked for the Diefenthal family at Southern Holdings and Southern Scrap. And then, you know, Abita was growing, and Jim and Rush did a great job, and they needed help. And so I came in December of 96 and started running the company.
Richard McCarthy from Slow Food USA likes to say, here in New Orleans, we were slow before anybody told us it was a good thing to be. And Abita Beer was craft beer before we knew that craft beer should exist in the world.
It's true. Like a lot of trends, they start on the coast and work themselves in. And, you know, when Abita started brewing in 86, you know, we're founded in 85. We say 86 because what does it matter? Paperwork means nothing, right? It's that physical part of brewing and selling beer. And so there really weren't that many of them. I don't remember from the top of my head, but there might have been like eight. We might have been one of the first 10 or something. Certainly that's in existence today.
Yeah.
Started up. And so, you know, in the Southeast, it was by far the first one. It wasn't even close.
From those early days, what beers are now your standards?
Well, our number one beer is amber, and it's a beautiful amber lager, and it was the first beer we ever brewed. And that and Golden, which we discontinued about 2 years ago. We really thought when we started out that Golden, which was a continental lager, which is more like the fresh-tasting European beer that you could get here,
mm-hmm.
we thought, that's going to be our number one beer. But, you know, it had a difference in that it was fresh and probably a little more maltier, and you know, which helped out with Louisiana cuisine. But it wasn't a huge point of difference. Where amber that was a radical beer back then. People talk about radical beers now, you know, 10+% alcohol and whatever, hoppy and bitter and whatever, you know, aged in, you know, cognac barrels, whatever.
Right.
So, you know, but you got to look back then. That was kind of extreme because it was so different. And it really was designed to go so well with our cuisine. It's so versatile. It's malty, but it is balanced. You know, there is some bitterness, but just enough to balance out the sweetness so it goes down smooth. And it really offsets really spicy or rich dishes very, very well. It stands the test of time. It's still our number one beer.
I don't think anybody was even thinking about pairing beer and food back then.
Well, coming from Louisiana, you have to do that. It's part of our social, you know, heritage, right? You know, we sit down to a meal and we like to enjoy it with friends and family. And it's not a holiday setting. It's a backyard barbecue. It's tailgating. And, we tailgate. There's food involved, right? Great food.
Right.
It's a gumbo cook or a crawfish boil. It's clubbing. It's all those things. And it also fine dining. It needs to stand on its own on a table. And I think beer really, really does well. Fine beer is great on a table because it really has a lot going for it. You know, the carbonation in itself is great with food because it scrubs the tongue of oils and lifts it kind of like a champagne would do and leaves you ready to taste again. And, you know, wine can't do that. And look, I like wine, don't get me wrong, but, you know, people always say wine and cheese pairings. I always laugh because it's like, the cheese sticks on your tongue, at least fatty cheeses, which I like the best.
Yeah.
And it does nothing to remove that off your tongue so you can really enjoy some more tastings of the liquid and the cheese. But beer does that, and certainly so versatile from the different flavors of, you know, blonde beers to dark beers to amber beers and all the different intricacies that you have on the brewing method, the ingredients, the hopping and bitter levels, the sweet, the sour. I mean, there's so much spectrum there that, you know, when you actually look at the flavor wheel that is used to describe wine and those to describe beer, the beer flavor wheel is about 30% larger than the wine one.
Incredible.
And we don't make things up either. Oh, this was grown on, you know, with, yeah. I could taste the tobacco.
Oh, I know, it's not all fussy quite like that. David, tell me how Abita grows. The growth that you all have experienced in profile, in distribution, in everything. I mean, you all have just become a giant in the industry in many ways.
Well, we're still very small in comparison to the larger brewers, but I hear what you're saying. There's no doubt. We're a top 20 craft brewer in the United States, and we don't have the population background like, you know, if we were in somewhere in the West Coast in a big city or, you know, in a bigger southern city like, let's say, Houston or Dallas or Atlanta, I mean, you look at our market share, you're, wow, we'd be this big. But we are a success story, but it's not me. I mean, it's the idea. It's the people. It's the team. It's the location.
It's the beer.
It's the water. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, things behind it. And you know, we're not one to pound our chest and, oh, you know, pat ourselves on the back. We just like doing what we're doing. And that in itself is our own reward. But when people enjoy it, you know, that's it. And we would not be here today if it wasn't for the culinary industry really taking us under their wings and putting us on the table and seeing our vision and really pushing us in the right direction and helping us out so much. In the beginning, our beers were all over the place, and they just were from batch to batch. They were different. Wanting to try and experiment with us with new things and being patient with us, that was very important, and I'm very thankful for that.
How do you all dream these things up? I love this this idea of you all being the big operation that you are with this flexibility of always wanting to try new things. And part of it has to do with the magic of your tasting room and people being able to come and visit your facility, right?
No doubt. And it's our best way to interact with our fans. And that's what you see is like a lot of locals bring in friends from out of town there. That's mainly what we have. And it's good to get the perspective of our local fan and those that haven't tried it yet or those that are a fan from out of town and can't wait to get there. And so there's a lot of energy there.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, we love that. And we show them a good time, you know, show them the place and give a great tour and sit around and taste great beer. I mean, our homebrewing background in our adventureness. You know, in Louisiana, we love cooking new things too. So you marry our culture with the homebrew spirit and love for making great beers. We want to do those things. And to see that backed up, like you're saying, in our tasting room and in other bars and restaurants is very, very important. And also with our social media channels and stuff, that people, our fans tell us, you know, and we follow them. You know, if they really like this or want to go another direction, you know, we think about it. We really do value their input.
Do you still brew at home?
I haven't brewed at home in quite a while. I try to get my nephews involved in it probably about 10 years ago, and that was the last homebrew I did. It's just so much easier when you talk to the brewmaster and the brewers and you say, well, I want it to taste like this and do that. And
oh, yeah.
Every once in a while, I'll make a recipe up myself, and it's easier to let them do it. And I have much better brewers than I am. And, you know, Mark Wilson's our brewmaster, born and raised in New Orleans, and he's fantastic. And he's got a great group of people, too. And we're doing 3 or 4 test brews a week. So we're constantly trying new things, and that's the homebrew spirit in us, is we always want to try new things and do things differently. And it just drives us to think about things like that. That's not the best business model. The best business model would be to stick to 1 or 2 brands, get behind them, and, you know, market them and do a great job with them. And that's really the import model. But that's not the craft spirit. You know, that we're adventurous and we want to try new things.
David Blossman, president of the Abita Brewing Company. After a short break, David tells us all about Abita's latest release, Crafted, to celebrate New Orleans Tricentennial. Stay with us. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Rouse's Markets, from Camellia Brand, Beans Done Right, a New Orleans tradition since 1923, and from Ralph's on the Park, featuring Chef Chip Flanagan's globally influenced New Orleans cuisine, overlooking City Park. Lunch, dinner, Sunday brunch, and private events at 900 City Park Avenue in New Orleans, Mid-City. Are you podcasting Louisiana Eats yet? If not, it's time to subscribe. We've launched a new podcast series, Louisiana Eats Quick Bites. To celebrate New Orleans Tricentennial, we'll be posting a series of Quick Bites podcasts all year, honoring historic New Orleans eats and eateries. You don't want to miss this, so subscribe today on our podcast page at poppytooker.com. That way, you won't miss a single serving of our broadcast or our Quick Bites podcasts. And now, back to Louisiana Eats. We've been speaking with David Blossman, president of the Abita Brewing Company. When we left off, David was talking about his love for adventurous brewing. Abita is constantly experimenting with new styles and flavors, regularly adding limited edition items to their assortment. Their latest creation, a tricentennial tribute that's cause for celebration. Let's talk about what's brewing in 2018 for the tricentennial of New Orleans.
Well, we're so excited that we're celebrating that here in this great city, and we wanted to do something special. And
how do you go about creating a beer to commemorate 300 years of tradition here in New Orleans?
Well, like any great decision, it's at the table, you know, enjoying a lunch and drinking a beer with my brew team and marketing team and really thinking about what can we do. And we bounce some ideas around, and we meet biweekly, honestly, and have a product development group, and we sit around, and that's what we do. We taste beers and drink and talk about it. And we had an idea with our French heritage, you know, although we do grow wine grapes here. But with our French heritage, to really do something different. And, you know, in Louisiana, we're always doing something different. And so to celebrate New Orleans' 300th year birthday, we decided that we were going to make a hybrid beer, which is really wine and a beer. And so we were going to brew it with Sauvignon Blanc grapes. And the Sauvignon Blanc grapes really have that beautiful grapefruit aroma and nice fruitiness, and it's a very big bouquet. It's not like a Chardonnay, which, you know, is more buttery or oaky. You know, we really thought that would really marry well with a lighter bodied, you know, lager or ale, really is what we did with it. And so what we did is we brewed them together, and it's very light in body, very effervescent, and it's fruity, and it's not filled. It's so light, it's almost like drinking champagne in that degree. And it tastes somewhat like a Sauvignon Blanc. So it kind of, and it almost, it tastes a little bit like beer. So it's kind of a hybrid between all of them. And it's great for people that love wine. It's great for people that love beer. And what people that really like drinking, or mainly wine drinkers, really love it is because it goes farther. It's 6.5% alcohol instead of 12. And you can drink more of it without getting as hammered on it. There's a lot of merit to it from a lot of different aspects.
What do you call a tricentennial beer that is almost like a champagne with elements of wine? When you get all of that wonderful celebratory stuff thrown in, what do you call it?
Well, I like to think of it like a house white, you know, and I don't speak proper French, and I know, you know, it should be Maison Blanche, like the department store. So again, you know, shopping there as a kid, that was in the back of my mind. I'm not saying that's the reason why we named it such.
But you can't call it Maison Blanche, because we're going to all think of something different.
So. Yeah, you're going to think of department store, right?
Maison Blanche.
And with the Blanc grapes, we just thought it was a nice cheeky way to talk about our past history with the department store and talk about the wine aspect of the beer by naming a Blanc. And so internally beforehand, we had those discussions and, you know, like, we can't, you know, do something that's not grammatically correct. I'm like, yeah, we can.
How do you expect Maison Blanc to be part of the tricentennial celebration?
We just want people to be there and enjoy it with it. So whether you're coming in to celebrate it from out of town, or you're here locally at the events, or just around the year, that you think about this and you enjoy it with whatever festivities you have going on. And we think it belongs at the table as well as at a ball game.
And what's the reception been?
It's been fantastic. We are on our third batch of it that we'll be making this week, and we're out. So first two batches, we make a batch, it's out. Do another one, it's out. And it's hard to judge demand, and this beer does take longer because of the wine aspect of it.
So how long does it take to produce?
It takes us about a couple of weeks to ferment it, and then we like to age it up to about 6 weeks. And most of our beers, so you look at that and say, by the time we brew it, it's in and out, it's 6 to 8 weeks. Our average time on most of our beers is about 3 weeks. So it's quite longer. But it's important for us to get the heat from the alcohol lower and bring down the smoothness of the wine of it. We had to age it longer. And honestly, I was surprised it was that fast, because I've made wine at home before, and it believe me, you don't want to drink wine that young.
No. Well, you know, and we're not going to drink a Maison Blanc before it's time.
That's right.
Right? That's what they say. Well, you know, David, I'd say there's only one thing left to do, and that's have a taste of this fabulous new Tricentennial Maison Blanc and have a toast to New Orleans, shall we?
Sounds great.
I can smell that fabulous Sauvignon scent coming out of the... This is crazy. Have y'all ever made a beer like this before?
No, this is the first. It's very effervescent. It has more CO2 content than most of our beers.
those exciting little bubbles. I don't think I've heard this much action since the last time we popped a cork of champagne in here. Thank you, David.
Thank you. Cheers.
That was David Blossman, president of the Abita Brewing Company. If you want to hear more about the many varieties of brews Abita has on tap, visit poppytooker.com. There you'll find our extended interview with David and my recipe for Creole carbonades, which uses Abita's dark brown ale Turbo Dog in the gravy. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats.
My name's Elizabeth Williams. I work at Earth Search, Inc. It's a cultural resource management consultant firm that did some of the excavations for the Historic New Orleans Collection.
And my name is Ryan Gray, and I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Anthropology and Sociology at the University of New Orleans.
My name is Lauren Noel, and I'm a marketing associate at the Historic New Orleans Collection.
Now that we're a few months into 2018, it's become clear that nearly everyone in New Orleans is commemorating the city's tricentennial in some way. So it's no surprise that the city's greatest archivists would also be in that number. But the Historic New Orleans Collection found their tricentennial tribute not along the city streets, but beneath them. The museum partnered with a team of archaeologists to uncover artifacts that speak volumes about the city's origins. We invited part of the research team to our studio, and archaeologist Elizabeth Williams began by explaining how they unearthed artifacts for the HNOC's New Orleans, the Founding Era exhibit.
The Historic New Orleans Collection had purchased a portion of what used to be the WDSU TV station in the French Quarter, and they elected to have archaeology done at the site. And even though they're a private organization, they didn't have to do it. They still chose to make sure that certain cultural resources, if they could be protected or, you know, gathered from this area, that they would be. We also did monitoring on the site as well to see if there were any deposits of importance that we could save them if necessary. And one of the portions of the property under construction was an area that we saw to be to have a deposit from the French colonial era. And it was very early. I mean, it seemed so to be. It was almost 7 feet deep. And so we got them to halt construction for a little bit for us to go in and salvage some of that material, which is now on display for the Historic New Orleans Collection.
So what did you find under there? What was there?
Well, we were lucky. We definitely found old bottles, old wine bottles that we assumed to be from French origin. We also found pottery on the site that we know was produced in France. It was called tin enamel earthenware, and we also call it French faience. And so we found that. And so that signaled to us that this could be an early colonial deposit. We also found lots of botanical seeds on site as well that we couldn't identify, you know, on the ground, but we still took them back to our laboratory and sent them to a specialist to process.
And what were those seeds?
Well, we found watermelon seeds, persimmon seeds, plum pits. We also found seeds that could be from either raspberry or blackberry.
Well, I just have to say about that raspberry or blackberry seed, that was one of the things that just really sort of twisted my brain. I can't imagine how somehow 7 feet down you even managed to find something as itty-bitty as a blackberry seed.
Mm-hmm.
What exactly do you go through to even begin to find and identify that? I mean, my goodness, to me, it would just look like another speck of dirt.
Sure. Well, a lot of these seeds were hand-selected, so we could see some of them. As you know, if you imagine a plum pit is kind of a little bit big, persimmon pit. The other one I forgot was a passion flower fruit seed. So we did hand select some of these. Usually in the field, we'll do what we call a flotation sample, which is when we gather a big portion of soil and then we add an adjutant to it and then we put that into a water type process and then we screen it through a sieve. And then we collect the smaller portions. So that's how we were able to identify the blackberry or the raspberry seed in that context.
And Ryan, what does this tell you about the people who were inhabiting that site?
You know, it's something that we're really only getting a good sample of now. Although there's been archaeology going on in the city of New Orleans for 50 years on and off, for a while, much of it was focused on the prehistory of the city, on prehistoric sites out in New Orleans East. Then it would just be often a matter of luck that it happened. Now, because of local institutions and organizations and private individuals giving us access to a more consistent selection of properties, we're getting a much more complete picture of early New Orleans through its material remains. So this is now at least the fourth site that I'm aware of that the Historic New Orleans Collection has allowed archaeological work to take place.
What are the things that you learned about the way they lived at that time?
To me, some of the most important things that this other work, that this body of work as a whole is telling us about, though, is just the role of indigenous peoples and of captive Africans and all these people coming together in the colonial era of the city. We have so much material culture that connects to indigenous peoples and to indigenous foodways, native foodways, and how those are influencing the French colonists, that we can start putting together a much richer picture of what daily life was like in the colonial city.
I'd love to know if there was ever one day that, you know, you're on a dig and you find something and you just go, oh.
Well, within that site, we did find this wine bottle, right? And it was full of 300 lead BBs.
And really?
Yes. And so it was just one of those moments where, and it was funny because, you know, we clean out the bottles that we do find with steel BBs because it's a nice cleaning agent. It's an adjutant. And so then we dump out all of the BBs and, you know, that's it. And so this time it was one of those situations where instead, I didn't put the steel BBs in yet, but yet I was shaking a container with BBs in it. And then I dumped it out and it was lead BBs from the historical period. So it was, I just thought, it tickled me so much. I thought it was so fun. And also just to think that someone might have repurposed this wine bottle to put lead BBs in. I mean, you just get into someone's mindset a little bit. And I just enjoyed that. I thought that was fun.
From people who have seen the exhibit, there's two things that I keep hearing about. I keep hearing about the gigantic oyster shell. Why was this particular oyster shell so remarkable that it's shown in this very significant exhibit?
I think part of it was that Erin Greenwald liked it and selected it to be part of the exhibit. And she said, oh, my gosh, that's one of the biggest oysters I've ever seen. But I do believe that, you know, oysters, of course, would have been a part of the diet of the early French colonists and likely the Native Americans before and then everyone that lived in the colony at the time.
Objects like that, you know, they speak to foodways, but they also give us some important clues about changes in the environment. So now that we're getting this much larger collection of material that we can securely date to the French colonial era in particular, and then to, you know, a separate layer from the Spanish colonial era and to, you know, different subsets of those, it's allowing us to start thinking about human impacts on the environment by looking at the objects left behind. So we're starting to notice that, you know, we have lots of different kinds of fish bone. You know, sheep's head, black drum, redfish, sunfish, you know, shoe pick, all sorts of things, brackish water fish, catfish, alligator gar, all of these things. I've been working with a zooarchaeologist, someone who specializes in the study of animal bone, and we're putting together this project to use the bone from all these different fish that we're finding, compare those to contemporary populations, come up with ways of estimating size, and use that as a way to think about the effect of human exploitation on, you know, coastal environments over time.
What are some of the things that you learn from finding these foodstuffs on the site?
Well, we can surmise about some of how it could have been prepared by not only looking at the artifacts and then also reading into some of the accounts, the earlier travelers' accounts from the first colonists over into this area. So one food type that we believe was made based on these accounts was persimmon bread. And so it would have been bread that was baked with some of the persimmon fruits. And again, we found some of the pits at the Historic New Orleans Collection site. So that could be one way that some of that was used. Another was preserves, possibly from some of the blackberry or raspberry seeds that we found on the site. And then there were some brief discussions of some medicinal usage for some of the passion flower or some of the raspberry and blackberry seeds, but not so sure how to be sure to say that that is what it was used for.
And the one thing that I might add to this is that often what we use to think about foodways in general, and archaeologists do think about foodways sort of more broadly than just food, because we think about how food was presented, how it was prepared, how it was stored, all of these interrelated things that we're observing often indirectly, and that's why archaeologists love ceramics, love pottery so much, because ceramic tablewares tell us about the rituals of dining, about class and status. The sorts of things that we find can tell us a little bit about how foods were stored and preserved. And these things give us this indirect clue to the importance of food more broadly considered.
Our listeners need to realize that there's not a lot of time to waste if they want to see this exhibit.
So this exhibition, New Orleans, the Founding Era, is not on view for very much longer. It is only up through May 27th of this year. So we encourage everyone to come and see it before it's gone. The objects that are in this exhibition are unlikely to ever be seen together again. Many of them are on loan from generous institutions in Europe and across North America from Canada. So we do have a couple of items on view from Versailles, but some of the other objects that we have on view come from the French archives for overseas colonies and from the National Archives in France and a number of different institutions. One of the objects that I find most fascinating is the initial plan for New Orleans has the French Quarter essentially almost in the shape of what looks like a pineapple. This construction of the city center never came to fruition. Eventually, someone else drew a new plan and it became the grid that we all know today. But these objects are fragile. We feel so lucky that these institutions allowed us to have them even for this short amount of time. But they are so fragile that they can't be on view for very long.
Because they can't even take that much light exposure,
they can't,
right?
Yeah, that's right. So we have a collection of maps that are from different institutions that show the progression of the clearing of the settlement for New Orleans. And they're all from different places, but they're maps. And so they're on paper. They're incredibly fragile. And whenever the exhibition closes, they're all going to go back to their disparate locations. So we really encourage everyone to get down to the French Quarter to 533 Royal Street to see this exhibition before it's gone.
Thank you all so much for coming to talk with us about this incredible exhibit and the amazing work that you all do.
Thanks very much for having us.
Thank you so much. It was good talking with you today.
That was Elizabeth Williams, Ryan Gray, and Lauren Noel, a few of the minds behind the Historic New Orleans Collection's Tricentennial Exhibit, New Orleans, the Founding Era, open now through May 27th. Who put the filet in your gumbo? Stay tuned. And we'll answer that question when we come right back. I'm Poppy Tooker, and you're listening to Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Louisiana Eats is brought to you with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Zatarain's, and from French Market Coffee. French Market Coffee's premium blended beans are locally roasted in small batches, creating a coffee that can only be called New Orleans Bold. Here's this week's culinary quiz question, brought to you with support from Popeye's Louisiana Culinary Institute. Who put the filet in your gumbo? It was the Choctaw Indians, who were some of New Orleans' earliest residents. When Bienville arrived here in 1718, he and his fellow explorers relied heavily on the Native Americans when the question became, what's for dinner? One of the most significant ingredients the Choctaw introduced to them was sassafras. Since the dawn of time, the Choctaw had used the native plant for flavoring and thickening foods and also for medicinal purposes. When ingested, sassafras can induce a sweat, perfect for breaking fevers. But when added to dishes in too great a quantity, the puzzling green powder could cause the liquid to be thready and a bit slimy. That's why the French called it filet, which means threads. The Choctaw name for filet was combo, K-O-M-B-O. Is that where gumbo gets its name? Most people believe the word gumbo was derived from the Bantu word for okra, keen gumbo. But you've got to admit, keen gumbo, combo. I don't suppose we'll ever know the answer for certain, but the next time you sprinkle filet powder on your gumbo, thank the Choctaws. I'm Poppy Tooker, and filet powder makes for some good Louisiana Eats. For more than 300 years, people from all over the world have called New Orleans home. The city's been influenced by cultures that range from African to Cuban, Vietnamese, French, Spanish, and many more. In the past several years, there's been an upsurge of interest in the history and culture of the Irish in New Orleans. Some of this can be attributed to historian Laura Kelley, whose book, The Irish in New Orleans, chronicles the stories of Irish immigrants in the Crescent City. Laura joined us to discuss what she's discovered in her many years of research on the topic.
Originally, it surprised me quite a bit to even find out that there were Irish in New Orleans, that there was this whole, you know, immigrant and ethnic group here, as I think it does many people. First time I tell people that my book, you know, The Irish in New Orleans, they say, the what? The who? You know, New Orleans, it's French, Spanish, Creole, and they say that like it's one word. But New Orleans has such incredibly rich history, and the Irish are an important component of that. So the Irish are here from the early French colonial period through the Spanish, but when do you move from being just a group of individuals who happen to be Irish to an, you know, ethnic community, a community? And we look at different markers to say, okay, this is when it's come together. And one of them is, of course, St. Patrick's Day. When do you celebrate a public feast day or saint's day that's associated with a particular group? And the earliest one here in New Orleans that I found documentation for is in March of 1806. So that is, yeah, so think about it. You know, we did the whole transfer with Louisiana Purchase in December of 1803. So this is 2.5 years later. And Governor Claiborne is there and, you know, various judges and other political people. So very similar to today. Certainly from 1806 forward, you see a lot of this continual public celebration of St. Patrick's Day. It may have happened earlier, but we don't have that many newspapers and it's hard to find evidence for. Other indications are when you build a church, when you have a charitable organization. So all of these things. And certainly Charitable organizations happened in the 18-teens, and St. Patrick's is built in 1833. So certainly by 1833, there is a strong Irish community here, but probably I would say earlier, recognizable one.
Everybody who's familiar with New Orleans is familiar with that area that we call the Irish Channel.
Yes.
How did that become the Irish Channel?
The Irish Channel is fascinating because New Orleans is known for its neighborhoods, and they're known for their neighborhoods having very distinct boundaries from this street to that street. And the Irish Channel is not that way. It's completely different. You know, people in the 1930s and 1940s were arguing that it was only Adele Street, just two blocks of Adele Street, which is now unfortunately underneath Walmart on Chapatoulas. And others said it was broader from Jackson to Felicity. And of course, the Historic Landmark Society came in and removed that, and they moved it from, you know, Jackson towards Louisiana. For me, a couple of different things are important to look at. If you want to know where any Irish community is in any city, look where their church is. And St. Alphonsus, located on Constant Street, is in the heart to me of the Irish Channel. And that's in that location between Jackson and Felicity. And it was a church that was built with Irish sweat and Irish pennies and built by those famine immigrants, as was St. John the Baptist and Saints Peter and Paul over on the other side of town. So that gives you an indication of where the Irish community was expanding upon and how you can kind of connect the dots. But the Irish Channel, per se, the first documentation we have of when that term is used, again, public documentation, is in 1893 in a newspaper article, and the fellow being interviewed uses it as if it's been used in common practice for a long time. But he's very vague on the boundaries. He kind of makes it sound like it's from Canal Street upriver. So there is no real definition. I think the Irish Channel is where the Irish heart is.
Well, why did the Irish people settle there?
Before the Civil War and at the height of this Irish immigration to the United States, New Orleans had per capita more Irish than Philadelphia, Baltimore, Chicago, and was on par with Boston. And there might even be a little debate if we actually had more than Boston. So New Orleans was really quite the Irish city. And why come here? It's a bustling economic engine. And where did they settle? You settle where work is. You know, we're living in, certainly then, in a walking city. And so where you live, where you work, where you go to church, where you send your children to school are normally all within walking distance. And while the Irish were involved in every type of occupation from, you know, from a drayman to a doctor to a teacher to a laborer, many of them worked in the port. And that was, you know, New Orleans was the second largest port in America. And so if you're working in the port, you're living near the port, and where's the Irish Channel? I mean, one thing that people do agree upon, it's below Magazine, right? Mm-hmm. So you're not that far from the river.
You have a whole chapter in the book that you call Irish Influence on the New Orleans Culinary Landscape.
Mm-hmm.
What is the Irish influence?
That is a great question, and I think you have to approach it from a lot of different ways. The Irish are known for actually their absence of foodways. If you look at the Italian, they have very strong foodways. And we associate certain dishes automatically. With the Irish, what do you associate with them? Potatoes and more potatoes.
But we don't really have any famous New Orleans potato dishes, do we?
No, we don't. And there aren't any more famous, you know, potato dishes, to be fair, to the Irish. And when I say an absence of foodways, the reason for their mass migration to the United States was the failure of one crop. It was the potato crop. And then you have to stop and ask yourself, how does the failure of one crop affect mass migration? Food is still being grown in Ireland. Mm. Well, it affects it when 60% of your population is eating solely or mainly just potatoes. How did they eat them? Two main ways, gruel or baked potato. And this was out butter and salt or pepper or anything. And so you have a devastation of a crop. You come to America and your association with food is famine. You know, your main one food source is famine. And when you study the Irish, what's one of the first things they do when they come to America? They become everybody's cooks. And I think one of the reasons they become their cooks is because they're like, teach me what you want. You know, they're kind of a tabula rasa. They're a blank slate. And I think in the city, what you see are individual Irish people who influence food in their own way, but not necessarily in a way that we would consider an Irish food way. So influence to me is people. It's like, you know, Dickie Brennan. Or it can be someone like Pauline Patterson taking a comfort food for her and adding a Louisiana twist to it.
Of course, you know, as we search for those thin culinary threads in New Orleans, there's one thing that it is not difficult to search for at all, because you can stumble across one in certainly every neighborhood, and that's the Irish bar.
Oh, pub, please.
Yes, okay.
Pub, please.
All
no,
right, okay.
There's a difference between a pub and a bar. You know, a pub is where you go when you want to share good news. A pub is where you go when you have really bad news and you want to just be with friends. It's, you know, an extension of your living room. And we have many of them here in the city, which is very good news for us. And I think that is a true Irish institute, because the first place an Irish-born person today, 20 years ago, 50 years ago, whenever would have done when they arrived new in the city, is they would have found the first Irish pub. And then they would have announced who they were, find out if there's anybody from their part of Ireland, look for a place to stay, look for work. In other words, that was your port of entry, you know, the church and a pub. And today, the church doesn't play that role really to the same degree, but a pub does. And a pub is very important to, I think, the Irish psyche, because, you know, over 100 million Irish people, you know, make up the diaspora. And with the economic downturn 2008, Ireland again began hemorrhaging people. And so when you're a stranger in a strange land, finding a comfortable, familiar place is very important. And that's what a pub does, pulling some draft beer and giving some whiskey to all of us. And whiskey to me is actually a great Irish foodways. Whiskey in Gaelic means the water of life. And that, I think, kind of says it all.
Historian Laura Kelley, author of The Irish in New Orleans.
All you heard for years in Ireland was the wearing of the green, but the biggest change has come in Ireland I have ever seen. All the laddies and the coolies laid aside their Irish reel, and I was born in Ireland, so imagine how I feel. Now Ireland's gone black bottom crazy. See them dance, you ought to see them dance.
That's it for this week's edition of Louisiana Eats, edible content for Louisiana food lovers. Have you missed an episode of Louisiana Eats? Hear today's show or catch up on previous editions anytime online at itsneworleans.com. If you're not podcasting yet, it's time to subscribe. We've launched an exclusive podcast series, Louisiana Eats Quick Bites, along with sneak previews of material that hasn't hit the airwaves yet and full-length interviews never heard on the show before. You'll also find our Tricentennial tributes devoted to New Orleans' historic eats and eateries. Visit our podcast page at poppytooker.com so you won't miss a single serving of our broadcast or our podcast. Louisiana Eats is made possible with major support from Popeye's Louisiana Kitchen, Zatarain's, French Market Coffee, Camellia Beans, and Rouse's Markets. Additional support for Louisiana Eats is provided by the Shreveport-Bossier Convention and Tourist Bureau, and with support from Dickie Brennan Steakhouse, a local New Orleans steakhouse serving prime beef and Louisiana Wagyu in New Orleans' French Quarter, where on May 8th, you can learn the art of butchering from internationally renowned Italian butcher, Dario Caccini. For more information, go to DickieBrennanSteakhouse.com. Original theme music by Johnny Sketch and the Dirty Notes. Big thanks to producers Joe Schreiner, Sarah Holtz, and Reggie Morris. And to our business manager and social media maven, Maddie Mulladew. Come visit us anytime in our Louisiana Eats studios at the Southern Food and Beverage Museum. Don't forget to find our recipes and see what we're up to at poppytooker.com. You can check us out on Instagram and Facebook, too. Louisiana Eats is a production of Poppy Tooker Broadcasting.